I, Ankita Dadwal, welcome you all in this fourth day of Teaching Marathon 2021. The topics that I'm going to cover in my sessions are liquidosis form and the introduction of additives that we are going to use in the liquidosis form. My second topic will be monophasic liquidosis form, and my last topic will be biphasic liquidosis form. In today's session, I'm going to start the introduction about the liquidosis form and the excipients that we are going to use in their preparation. So let us start. The contents that we are going to cover in today's session is introduction to dosage form, introduction about liquidosis form, and the classification of the liquidosis form. Advantages of liquidosis form, disadvantages of liquidosis form, and the excipients that are used in the formulation of liquidosis form. And last one will be the approaches in improving aqueous solubility. Before starting liquidosis form, we must understand what a dosage form means. Dosage form are the means by which the drug molecules or the APIs are delivered to the site of action within the body to produce optimum desired effect and minimum adverse effect. It means the dosage form is formed of drug and the excipient, which we use to get the desired effect with minimum side effects. Why there is a need of dosage form? The dosage forms are need to The dosage forms are need for the drug safety benefits and for the patient safety benefits. For example, in drug safety benefits, we'll take an example. If we are taking a drug and it is degraded at acidic pH, for that we need we cannot take that drug directly. So we have to formulate it into a dosage form so that it should not degrade when it comes in pH that is present in acidic, that is present in our stomach. Similarly, for the patient safety benefits, if a dosage form is cause irritation at acidic pH, so in that case, if we take that dosage medicament directly without formulating it into dosage form, in that case, the patient will cause irritation to the patient. So in that case also, we need dosage forms. Dosage forms are the combination of active pharmaceutical ingredients, that is your drug, treatment, prevention of diseases. Or active pharmaceutical ingredient is a part of any dosage that produces its effect. It means these are those forms that gives us pharmacological actions. Now, what are excipients? Excipients do not increase or affect the therapeutic action of active ingredients. They are inactive ingredients, which also refers as inert ingredients. They generally have no pharmacological effect. Examples of inactive ingredients or excipients include binding agents, dyeing, preservatives, flavoring agents, sweetening agents, and coloring agents, and many more. Now the question arises why we cannot use the active drug substances directly? Why we have to formulate a dosage form? We cannot use active drug directly because the handling and the accurate dosing of the active pharmaceutical are very difficult or impossible. Suppose we have a potent drug. Potent drugs are those drugs which are active, which shows their effect at lower concentrations. Means we can take them into low mg's or microgram doses. So it is very difficult to handle or to take such small doses. So we cannot take active ingredients directly. The second reason is the API administration can be impractical, unfeasible because of their size, shape, smell, odor, taste, and low activity. Suppose an active ingredient is very, very bitter in taste, or it has a foul odor. So we cannot take that active ingredient directly. Patient will not be able to swallow that drug directly. So for that, we have to formulate that active drug into an dosage form. Some APIs are chemically instable in light, moisture, and O2. Means, so if we keep the active ingredients in open, they will get oxidized or they will get hydrolyzed because of the atmospheric condition. So that is also one of the reason that we cannot take active ingredients directly. APIs can degrade at the site of administration. As I already given you that example, suppose if you're taking a drug and that drug is degraded at lower pH, as soon as that drug will reach in our stomach, it will start degrading. So we don't want that. For that, I have to coat my drug with such a polymer that it should not release or it should not be in direct contact with the acid that is present in our stomach. So this is the another reason why we cannot take active ingredients directly. API may cause local irritation or injury when they are present in high concentration at the site of administration. If some drugs shows local irritation, if they are direct contact with the in the area where which we are administering them. So we cannot administer the API directly in that particular areas to avoid the local irritation. Administration of active ingredients would mean to have no change in the modification or improvement of their PK profile. We cannot change the solubility or bioavailability of a drug. It will always give the same. If we are not adding any additive with them, if we are not formulating into a particular dosage form, we cannot control their action. We cannot control their PK profile. So if we want to improve the, or if we want to control the release of the drug, it is necessary to formulate it into a dosage form. So all these are the reasons why we cannot take active ingredients directly. Then there will be a need of dosage form. So what is the importance of dosage form? Dosage form provide us the safe and convenient delivery of accurate dose. For example, if we formulate a drug in a tablet, we can easily take a dose, an accurate dose that is already present in that tablet. We don't have to measure and there will be no inconvenience in taking that tablet. So dosage form provide us a convenient mode to take the drugs. Protection of drugs against the atmospheric oxygen and moisture. As some of the drugs, when they comes in contact with the environment, they get degraded or they get oxidized. We can also prevent all these things if we coat our excipients with such polymers. We can coat our capsules, we can coat our tablets. And there are also sealed ampoules that helps in preventing the direct contact of the active ingredients to the atmospheric conditions. The protection of drug substance from the gastric acid after oral administration. As I already told you, there are some drugs that can cause gastric irritation or that can be degraded at lower pH. For that drugs, we use enteric coated tablets. There are some enteric coated polymers. We use to coat our drugs with those enteric coated polymers. Those polymers helps us to release the drug, helps us to control the release of the drug in the intestine region. So in the intestine region, the pH will be higher. So the drug will not degrade or cause any kind of irritation and we will get a localized effect also. Concealing bitter taste and odor of the drug substances. Dosage form also help us to conceal the bitter taste and the odor of foul odors of the drug substances. If a drug have a bitter taste, we can easily encapsulate them. we can add sweetening agent, we can add flavoring agents. So by formulating a doses form and by adding all these excipients, we can improve the taste and the odor of a drug. And the patient will be able to take it easily. Provide liquid preparations of drug that insoluble and unstable in the desired vehicles. Some of the drugs are not soluble in a particular vehicle that we want. In that case, we can prepare suspensions. Suspensions are the biphasic doses form in which the solid particles, which is not soluble in the vehicle, are suspended by the help of suspending agents. So we can also dispense those drugs which are insoluble in some vehicles by making their suspensions. Whereas some formulations are can get easily solubilized in the liquid forms. And in that case, we form solutions. Provided optional drug actions for topical administration site. If we want a local action or if we want to give to apply our drug on the topical area, topical means on the skin area, there are different types of doses form that are present, like ointments, creams, air and nasal preparations. We can use these preparation if we want a topical administration. Provide for insertion of drug into one of the body orifice. There are many formulations that we can use if we want a targeted and a local action. For that, we use suppositories. There can be rectal or vaginal suppositories that we use if we want an localized action. Extended drug action through controlled release mechanisms. We can control the release of the drug by two ways. One is your temporal, another one is your spatial. If I control the release rate of the drug for a longer period of time, it will come under the category of temporal. Means, even on a single administration, I can release my drug for a longer period of time. But if I want my drug to be released at a specific site, then it will termed as a spatial. It means if I want a targeted action, in that case, I will go for this controlled release type of tablets. Another doses form is implants. In this, the drug is drug action is through the inhalants. In this, the drug action is through the inhalation therapy. Many doses forms can be easily identified from their distinct color, shape, and identifying marks. So because of using the colorants, we can easily give the color and enhance the appearance of any formulation by using the colorants. So these are the importance of doses form. This is why we need doses form. We cannot take API directly. Now the classification of doses form. There are three classes of doses form. One is solid doses form, another one is liquid, and next is semi-solid doses form. Solid doses forms are divided into two categories. One is unit doses form, another one is your bulk doses form. Unit doses forms are tablets, capsules, powders, and pills. Bulk doses forms are further classified into two categories. One is internal, another one is external. The internal doses forms are fine powders and granules. The external doses forms are dusting powders, dendrifies, and snuffs. Similarly, the liquid doses forms are also classified into two categories. One is biphasic liquid doses form, another one is monophasic liquid doses form. In biphasic liquid doses form, the examples are emulsions and suspensions. And in monophasic liquid doses form, they are further classified into two categories. One is internal, another one is external. In internal liquid doses forms, the examples are syrups, elixirs, linctures, drops. And for external preparations, liniments, lotions, gargles, throat paints, mouthwashes, sprays, eye lotions, eye drops, and nasal drops are there. And the last dosage form is semi-solar dosage form. These are further classified into two categories. One is internal, another one is external. Suppositories and pessaries comes under the internal category, and ointments, creams, paste, and jellies comes under external categories. These solar dosage forms is already covered by Dr. G.D. Gupta, and this semi-solar dosage form is already covered by Dr. Daisy Arora. We are going to discuss these liquid dosage forms. So let us start the liquid dosage form. First, the introduction about the liquid dosage form. What are liquid dosage form? Liquid dosage form is a pharmaceutical product involving a mixture of active drug component and non-drug components. Active drug component means drugs, and non-drug component means excipients. Liquid dosage forms are meant for internal, parenteral, or external use. They are available in the monophasic and biphasic forms. Now, what are monophasic forms? As from the name, you can easily understand that mono means single, phasic means phase. The dosage form which have single phase means which are homogeneous and uniform throughout the solution are known as monophasic dosage form. True solutions are the examples of the monophasic dosage form. Similarly, biphasic dosage form means bi means two, phasic means phase. Those dosage form which have two phases are known as biphasic dosage forms. Emulsions and suspensions are the examples of biphasic dosage form. There are potential advantages of oral dosage form because, unlike tablets, these liquid dosage form do not have to go through the dissolution and disintegration process. So they shows a rapid rate of absorption through the stomach and the intestine as compared to tablets, which may be an important factor in the case of pain relieving drugs. But inherent to this benefit, there is a risk of reaching peak plasma level too fast, which could be harmful. Finally, as the excipient technologies are advancing nowadays, we can easily control the release of the drugs from these liquid preparations. And we can easily monitor the release of these drugs from this liquid preparations. There are different methods by which we can prepare the liquid dosage forms. There are three types of methods. First is by dissolving the active ingredient in the solvent. This method is used in the case of monophasic liquid dosage form. This is only used when the solute is completely soluble in the solvent. But when the solute is not soluble in the solvent, in that case, we use this second system, that is the suspending active ingredients in the solvent. For that, the solids that are not solubilized in the solvent systems should be suspended in the solid systems by the help of any suspending agents. And the example for this second type is suspensions. And the third system is by incorporating active ingredient into oil or water phase. We can incorporate the drugs that are soluble in oil in the oil phase and the drugs which are soluble in water in the water phase, and we can make the emulsion of that oil in water by using an emulsifying agent, and that we see in emulsions. This is the third form of the form by which we can prepare the liquid dosage form. Now, what are the advantages of the liquid dosage form? Used for the patient who cannot swallow. For example, if a patient is fainted and he cannot swallow a dose at a tablet at that time, in that case, we can give this liquid dosage form to that patient. As I already discussed, these dosage form has a fast rate of absorption because, unlike tablets, they do not have to go through disintegration and dissolution. So they show rapid absorption from their site. So this is also, we can use this benefit we can use in pain relieving tablets. And the next important advantage of the liquid dosage form is that they are flexible in achieving the proper dosing. Means we can easily change the dose according to our requirement. Suppose if the same formulation is given to a child or the same formulation is given to an adult. For the child, we can take only 1 tablespoon, and for the adult, we can take 2 tablespoons. Matlab, it means that we can adjust the dose. The best choice for the children's and the elders are the liquid dosage form. Because children's and elders have difficulty in swallowing the drugs, so it is very easy to give them liquid dosage form. There are also some disadvantages of liquid dosage form. And these are, they have shorter shelf life due to their low stability. As the liquid dosage form has low stability, so they show shorter half-life, shelf life, and hence has less accuracy. As in tablets, the dose is already fixed in that tablet, in a unit dose, is already in there in that tablet. We do not have to take it by ourselves. It is already present in that tablet, so we can easily take that tablet. But in the case of liquid dosage form, dose accuracy is very less. Need of special storage and transferring conditions. Because of their liquid nature, their storage and their transferring needs a special conditions. It is easily infected by microorganisms. Most of the liquid dosage forms, we use water as a vehicle in them. So there is a chance of a microbial growth in them. We need to add antimicrobial agents while preparing them, while preparing the liquid dosage form. Hence, the storage required special requirements. We have to store the liquid preparations in a for the storage of the liquid preparation, we need a special storage conditions. Now, the classification of liquid dosage form. Liquid dosage forms are classified into 2 categories. One is your monophasic liquid dosage form. Another one is your biphasic liquid dosage form. Monophasic means that contains only one phase, and biphasic means it contains two phases. Monophasic liquid dosage forms are further classified into liquids for internal use and liquids for external use. Examples of the liquids for internal use are drops, elixirs, linctors, syrups, and draughts. Liquid for external use are further classified as liquid to be applied on skin and liquid meant for the body cavities. The liquids that are applied on skin are liniments and lotions. The liquids that are meant for body cavities are gargles, throat paints, mouthwashes, eye lotions, ear drops, nasal drops, sprays, and inhalations. In biphasic liquid dosage form, there are 2 types. One is your suspension, another one is your emulsion. In suspension, insoluble solute particles are suspended in the liquid vehicles with the help of a suspending agent. In emulsion, 2 immiscible liquids are mixed together with the help of emulsifying agents. This is the classification of liquid dosage form. Now, we will discuss the pharmaceutical excipients that we use in the liquid dosage form. This is our next topic. First, we have to understand what a pharmaceutical excipient means. We can also say that they are pharmaceutical additives, they are pharmaceutical aids, pharmaceutical necessities, adjuvants, or pharmaceutical excipients. We can use any of these names for the pharmaceutical excipients. Substances which are of little or no therapeutic value but which are added in the formulation. These substances, these excipient does not have any therapeutic effect or any therapeutic value. They are just added in the formulation to help in the production, to maintain the physicochemical stability of the formulation, to improve the patient acceptability, or to improve the functioning of the dosage form as a drug delivery system. The ideal properties of a pharmaceutical additives are, they are physiologically inert, they should be physiologically stable, means they should not degrade when they come in contact with any pH of our body, any fluid of our body. They do not impart any undesirable taste, color, and odor. These additives should not be bitter in taste, or they should not have any kind of foul odor, or they should not give any color when they are mixed with the formulations. Now, they should be non-toxic, non-irritant, and non-sensitizing. The next ideal property is that they should be effective in their low concentration. It means the property for which a particular excipient we are using, it should give that property in its low concentration. They should be free from microorganisms. As many pharmaceutical products, as mainly in liquid pharmaceutical products, we use water as a vehicle. If there is a microbe present, the degradation of the liquid formulation will be very quick. So to improve that, there is no these additives should be free from microorganisms. They should not interfere with the bioavailability of a drug. In any way, these additives should not come in pathway, or they should not interfere the bioavailability of the drug. And all the additives that we are using should be approved by the regulatory authorities. These are the some examples of the pharmaceutical additives that we use in our liquid preparations. These are vehicles, buffers, density modifiers, stabilizers, tonicity modifiers, viscosity enhancement, preservatives, sweetening agents, reducing agents and oxidants, antioxidants, and colorants. These are the few examples of the additives that we use in the liquid dosage form. Now we are going to discuss all these additives one by one. Our first additive is the vehicle. Now, what is vehicle? Vehicle is a pharmaceutical formulation or the liquid bases that carry drug and other excipient in dissolved and dispersed state. Means vehicle is that liquid in which we dissolve our drug as well as our excipient in it. This vehicle is responsible for the liquid state of the preparation. Vehicles are classified under two categories. One is aqueous vehicles, another one is non-aqueous vehicles. Now, what are aqueous vehicles? Water, hydroalcohols, polyhydric alcohols, and buffers are termed as aqueous vehicles. Water is the solvent that is most widely used as a vehicle in the pharmaceutical products. And why we use water so widely? Because of its pharmacological compatibility and lack of toxicity. Because water is not toxic and it is pharmacological, its pharmacological compatibility is high. So that is the reason we use water in our as an aqueous vehicle most widely. It possesses a high dielectric constant, and which is essential for ensuring the dissolution of the wide range of ionized materials. Because of the high dielectric constant of the water, the ionic drugs can be easily solubilized in the waters. That is also one more reason why we use water most widely as an aqueous vehicle. Second category is non-aqueous vehicles. The non-aqueous vehicles are fixed oil of vegetable origin, alcohols, polyhydric alcohols, dimethyl sulfoxides, ethyl ethers, liquid paraffins, miscellaneous solvents. These are the examples of known aqueous vehicles. Now we are going to discuss each of these vehicles individually in our next slides. First is your fixed oil of vegetable origin. These are the non-volatile oils that consist mainly of fatty acids, esters of glycerol. Example of fixed oils are almond oil, which consists of glycerides, mainly the oleic acid, and it is used as a solvent for the oily phenol injections. Argis oil is also used as a solvent in the dimercaprol injections. Other examples of vegetable oils are olive oil, sesame oil, maize oil, cottonseed oil, soya oil, and the castor oil. These oils are suitable for the parenteral eye eardrop formulations. Ethyl oleate is useful solvent for both ergocalciferol injections and testosterone propionate injections. Vegetable oils are also used for the veterinary formulations. So these are the few examples of the first known aqueous vehicle, that is fixed oil. A second known aqueous vehicle is alcohol. Ethyl alcohol is most widely used solvent in this class, particularly for their external use. Whereas it evaporates and produces cooling sensation, so it can also be used in the preparation of lotions where we want cooling effect. Example of this is salicylic acid lotion. At concentration greater than 15%, ethanol acts as an antimicrobial agent, means it gives antimicrobial activity. But because of its toxicity, it is used orally or parenterally at low concentrations only. If we want to use it above 15%, then we will use it only for external preparations, not for internal preparations. It is also used as a co-solvent with water. Now, what are co-solvents? When a drug shows poor water solubility, to increase the solubility of that drug in water, we will add a solvent along with the water in which the drug has a greater solubility. Means we will add alcohol along with the water and the drug should be soluble in alcohol. In this way, we can increase the solubility of that particular drug in that particular vehicle. In some cases, isopropyl alcohol is also used externally as a solvent. Your next alcohol is polyhydric alcohols. Alcohol containing two hydroxyl groups per molecule are known as glycols. But because of their toxicity, they are rarely used internally. Propylene glycols is the only excipient that we use internally. It is often used in conjugation with water or glycerol as a co-solvent. It is used in the formulation of digitoxin injection, phenobarbital injection, etc. In these preparations, we can use this propylene glycols. These are used in the various ranges like PET-400, PET-600 and many more. Glycerols and alcohols possessing three hydroxyl groups per molecule is also used as a co-solvent with water for oral use. next known aqueous vehicle is dimethyl sulfoxide. This is the highly polar compound and is thought to be aid the penetration of the drug through the skin. Used as a solvent for veterinary drugs and as a penetration enhancer for transdermal systems. As I already told you, transdermal means those systems which are applied on the skin. So in that cases, this disulfoxide, as it is a penetration enhancer, so it will help our drug to penetrate through the skin. Our next compound is ethyl ether, widely used in the extraction of the crude drugs. It is not used internally. It is used as a co-solvent with alcohol in some conditions. Our next known aqueous vehicle is liquid paraffin. The oily nature make it unpleasant, so it is used externally. We will not use liquid paraffin for the internal preparations. We will use it for external preparations only because of its oily nature. It is used as a solvent for the topical application of the drugs in the emulsions, in the emulsion formulations. It is widely used as a base for nasal drops. Now the last category is miscellaneous solvents. Isopropyl palmitate used in the cosmetics. Dimethyl formaldehyde, dimethyl acetamide used as a solvent in the veterinary preparations. Xylene is present in some air drops for human use to dissolve the air wax. These are the few further examples and applications of the known aqueous vehicles in the liquid preparations. Now, the first excipient that we have discussed is the vehicles. Now, the second excipient that we use in the liquid preparations are buffers. We all know buffers are the materials which, when dissolved in the solvent, will enable the solution to resist the change in the pH. Pharmaceutical buffers are carbonates, citrates, gluconates, lactates, phosphates, or tartrates. It must be compatible with other excipients and have a low toxicity. Means the buffer should be compatible with the other excipient and it should not produce any kind of toxicity. Why we need to maintain the pH of the body? Why we need to maintain the pH of the formulation? Why we need buffer? Because buffer will resist the change in the pH. It means we want to maintain the pH of the formulation. It is because some drugs will degrade if there is a change in the pH. To stop that degradation, we need to add these buffers so that we can resist the change in the pH. Some body fluids, for example blood, have pH of 7.4. Products such as injections, eye drops and nasal drops should be buffered so that their pH should not change. Because if their pH will be changed, they will cause irritation when they are applied. So to resist these changes, we use buffers in our formulation systems. Choice of the buffers depends on the pH and the buffering capacity required. What is the pH and what is the buffering capacity we need in our formulation? We choose our buffer on basis of these two parameters. Now, what is buffering capacity? We donate it with beta. Buffering efficiency, buffering index, or buffering value is the resistance of a buffer to the pH change upon addition of strong acid or base. Means if we add a strong acid or a base in a solution, the buffer that is present in the solution will resist the change in the pH. The capacity the extent up to which it can resist that change is known as buffer capacity. The ratio of the amount added of strong base or strong acid to the change in the pH brought by their addition is known as buffer capacity. The formula for this is beta delta B divided by delta pH. Delta B is the small addition in grams equivalent per liter of strong base added to the buffer solution to produce a pH change. And delta pH is the change in the pH which occurs when we add a strong base or a strong acid in our formulation. Now, the third excipient that we use in the liquid preparation is density modifiers. Density modifiers are rarely used. They are not widely used in the preparation of the liquid formulation, but when we are formulating the preparations for the spinal anesthetics, in that case, these density modifiers plays an important role. The fluid present in cerebrospinal is isobaric in nature. So, the solution of lower density than the cerebrospinal fluid can cause a problem is hypobaric. And if the density of our solution of our anesthetic is more than the density of this cerebrospinal fluid, the condition will be hyperbaric. So, to avoid those things, we make a solution which is isobaric to the cerebral fluid. Our next excipient is isotonicity modifiers. Isotonicity modifiers means the solution for injection or application to the mucous membrane are the large volume solutions for ophthalmic use should be made isotonic with the tissue fluids to avoid pain and irritation. And for this, dextrose solution and sodium chloride solutions are largely or widely used to adjust the tonicity of the formulation. Now, why we need to adjust the tonicity? Why we need these tonicity modifiers in our liquid formulation? Suppose you are injecting a drug which is isotonic to our blood. In this diagram, you can see this is the red blood cell. This membrane of the red blood cell will act as a semi-permeable membrane. It will allow water to pass through and out of itself. If the solution is isotonic, the amount of water that is entering in the this red blood cell is equal to the amount of water that is passing out of the cell. So the shape of the this red blood cell will be as such as it was before. But if our solution is hypertonic in nature, it means hyper means high. If our solution have a higher concentration than the concentration which is present inside this red blood cell, in that case, because every system wants to achieve an equilibrium, to maintain that equilibrium, osmosis will take place. Means the water will move from the lower concentration to the higher concentration. In this case, as our solution is hypertonic in nature, it means the concentration outside this cell is higher than the concentration inside of this cell. So to overcome this difference, concentration difference, the water inside of the cell will start moving outside. And because of that, shrinkage of the cell will take place. Similarly, in hypotonic solution, hypo means less. If our solution that we are if the solution that we are giving is hypotonic from the red blood cells, from the solution that is present inside the red blood cells, it will cause swelling of the cell. As I already told you, because every system want to achieve an equilibrium, means they want to maintain their concentration equal in both the sides. But if the concentration of the solute is more inside the red blood cell and it is less outside the red blood cells, the water from the outer region will start moving to the inner region of the cell to dilute the solutes that are present inside the cell so that an equilibrium can be achieved. In that case, the swelling of the cell will take place. As the water enter inside the cell, the swelling of the cell will take place. Sometimes it also bursts. To avoid these irritation and to avoid these kind of pain, we need an isotonicity modifiers in our liquid preparations. Next one is viscosity enhancement. It may be difficult for aqueous based topical solutions to remain in the place of the skin or the eye for a significant time because of their lower viscosity. It can counteract this effect. Lower concentration of the gelling agents can be used to increase the apparent viscosity of the product. Means, if I want to apply the formulation through a transdermal route, means if I want to apply the formulation on a skin, I want that my formulation should retain on my skin for a particular period of time so that my drug can easily penetrate through the skin. But if my solution have a low viscosity, it will not retain on my skin. For that purpose, I need these viscosity enhancers so that it will stick on the skin for a longer period of time and the drug can easily penetrate and can give its action. These viscosity enhancers can also be used in the case of preparations of suspension. As we know that in suspensions, those solids which are immiscible in liquids are suspended by the help of a suspending agent. As the solids are immiscible in liquid, so because of gravity, they are going to sediment downwards after a period of time. But if we increase the viscosity of the solution, we will find that the rate of sedimentation is slower now. So we can also use these viscosity enhancers to decrease the sedimentation in the suspensions. The example of these viscosity enhancements are HPMC, HEC, and carbomer. These are the polymers that we use to enhance the viscosity in a liquid preparations. The next excipient that we use in the preparation of liquid dosage form are reducing agent or antioxidant agents. Why we need this? Because liquid preparations will come in direct contact with the atmosphere. The oxygen that is present in the atmosphere can oxidize the drug molecules that are present in our formulation. So to avoid this kind of things, we use reducing agent and antioxidants. The decomposition of the pharmaceutical products by oxidation can be controlled by the addition of reducing agent. Examples are sodium meta bisulfate or antioxidants such as butylated hydroxyanisole or butylated hydroxytoluene, butylated hydroxyacetate, and phthalate. These are the few examples of antioxidants that we use in the preparation of liquid dosage form. Our next excipient that we use in the formulation of liquid dosage form is preservatives. As in liquid preparations, we use water as a main ingredient, as a main vehicle in many of the formulations. These water promotes the microbial growth. So to avoid these kind of growths, we use these preservatives. In recent year, adequate preservation of liquid products has increased in importance. The liquid can be contaminated from different sources. And the source of contamination can be a raw material, processing containers or the equipments, the manufacturing environment, the operator, and the packaging material, or many more. These are the sources from which the liquid can be get contaminated. So to avoid it, we need the preservatives. And to avoid these contaminations, we need preservatives. Now, what should be the ideal properties of a preservatives that we use? First is, it must be effective against a broad spectrum of microorganisms. Means if we are adding a preservative in our formulation, it should be active against the broad spectrum of microorganisms. The preservatives that we are using should be non-toxic, non-sensitizing, adequately soluble, compatible, and acceptable with respect of taste and odor. Means these preservatives should not impart any bad taste or any bad odor in our formulation. Our next excipient that we are using in the liquid dosage forms are sweetening agent. Sucrose is the most common sweetening agent that we use in the liquid preparation. And why we use most widely this sucrose is because it is colorless and it is very soluble in water. And it also shows stability over the wide pH range, that is from 4 to 8 pH. Means if there is change in the pH from 4 to 8, sucrose is still stable. It also increases the viscosity of the fluids. These are the reasons why we use sucrose most widely as a sweetening agent in our formulations. There are other sweetening agents also that we can use in our liquid preparations. The examples are sorbitol. They are half sweeter than the sucrose. We can also use honey. Saccharine sodiums can be used as sweetening agents. These saccharine sodiums are 300 to 550 times more sweeter than the sucrose. Aspartates are also used. Low molecular weight carbohydrates like sucrose are traditionally used as the sweetening agent. Why we need sweetening agents? Because if we are preparing a liquid dosage form and the drug that we are disposing in that liquid dosage form, if it is bitter in taste, it is very difficult for a patient to take that liquid dosage form. To avoid that bitter taste, to overcome, to mask that bitter taste of that medicine, we need these sweetening agents. Our next category is flavoring agent. Only 6 artificial flavors are permitted for the oral use within the European Union. They are sodium or calcium salts of saccharin, aspartate compounds like L-aspartic acid and L-phenylalanine, humectant, sodium chlamide, and neohesperamidine. These are the few artificial sweeteners, flavoring agents that are approved under the European Union. The use of flavoring agent is usually a composite sensation of taste, touch, smell, sound, and heat. All above mentioned factors involve a combination of physicochemical and physiological actions influencing the sensitivity of the substance. There are simply 4 types of taste: sweet, sour, salty, and bitter. And some others are the combination of these above. Similarly, there are 7 basic odors like pungent, putrid, ethereal, camphorous, musky, floral, peppermint. Pungent means a sharp odor. Putrid means when an organic compound is decomposed, the smell that that appear from that compound is resembles with this putrid odor. Ethereal means ether like smell. Camphorous means camphor like smell. Musky means it is a sharp, sweet odor. Floral means flowers like smell, and pepperminty means peppermint like smell. These are the 7 basic odors that we use in our preparations. Now, the classification of the flavoring agents. Flavoring agents are classified as natural flavoring agents and synthetic flavoring agents. There are different parts of the plant where from which we can get the natural flavoring agents. First part is fruit. They are sweet, sour, and astringent. Citrus fruits such as orange and lemon and raspberry and strawberries are used as a flavoring agents for the liquid preparations. Second is seeds. Vanilla, anise, nutmegs are the seeds that we use. Buds and flowers, orange flower water, clove blossoms we use as a flowering part that we use as a flavoring agents. In leaves, we can use thyme and rosemary. In roots, we use glycyrrhiza. In barks, we use white pine, cinnamon, wild cherry bark. In woods, we use acacia. Gums that we use are gum arabic, and gum tragacanth. These all are the natural sources from which we can get the flavoring agents. Now, the synthetic sources. The examples of the synthetic sources are alcohol, aldehydes, fatty acids, and esters. These are the examples of the synthetic flavoring agents. Now, the next excipient is coloring agents. Why we need coloring agents? Because these coloring agents enhance the appearance of the liquid formulation. They will make more liquid formulation more attractive. They are also classified as natural coloring agent and artificial coloring agent. The natural coloring agent is further classified into 2 categories. One is from the plant source, another one is from the animal source. Many plants contain coloring agents which may be extracted and used as colorant. Examples are chlorophyll green, annatto seeds yellow to orange, carrot yellow, medlar plant reddish yellow, indigo blue, saffron yellow, caramel burnt sugar. These are the examples of the coloring agents that we get from the plant source. Now, the coloring agents that we get from the animal sources are cochineal. It is an alkaline solution of the soluble coloring principles, caraminic acids of cochineal insects preserved by glycerin. It gives dark purplish red color. Caramine. This is the second example from the animal based coloring agents. This caramine consists of aluminium lac of coloring principles obtained from the cochineal. It gives red color to the aqueous solutions. Next is minerals. Mineral colors are the termed pigments. They are used as colors in lotion, cosmetics, and other preparations for external application. Mineral colors are toxic in nature, so we cannot use them for the internal preparations. Their internal use is forbidden. So we only use them for the external preparations. The example of the mineral colors are red ferric oxide, yellow ferric oxide, titanium dioxide, carbon black. The next classification is synthetic coloring agents. The synthetic colors are coal tar dyes because many of them are produced from substances obtained from coarta. The certified colors are classified into three groups. Group 1 contain food, the colors that comes in group 1 are food, the colors that are used for food, drugs and cosmetic. In group 2, the colors that are classified are used for drugs and cosmetics only. The third category is for the external use, in the third categories, the colors that are classified in the third categories are only for the external use in the drugs and the cosmetics. Any color found in any of these list is spoken as permitted color, means any color that is listed in these three groups will be spoken as the permitted color, like blue, brilliant blue, indigo carmine, green fast green, guinea green, violet wood violet, red amaranth, erythrosin, sclerene red, yellow, tartarizine and sunset yellow. These are the few examples of the of these synthetic colors that we use in our liquid preparations. Now, let us understand the different approaches to enhance the solubility of a substance. There are different techniques by which we can enhance the solubility of the substance. First one is co-solvency. Second one is pH control. Third one is complexation. Fourth one is microionization. Next is hydrotropy. And last one is solubilizing or wetting agents and surfactants. By using these techniques, we can enhance the solubility of the preparations. Let us discuss about the first technique, that is co-solvency. The solubility of the poorly water-soluble drugs can be increased by adding addition of water miscible solvent in which the drug has a good solubility. For example, if a drug is insoluble in water, we will use some other solvent as a co-solvent in which the drug shows its miscibility. But there is a condition that other solvent should also have the solubility in water. For example, if a drug is not soluble in water and it is soluble in alcohol, and alcohol is also soluble in water, in that case, that alcohol can be used as a co-solvent, because alcohol also solubilizes that drug in itself and it is also soluble in the water. By this process, we can increase the solubility of a poorly water-soluble drug. The whole procedure is known as co-solvency, or the solvent is known as co-solvent. Co-solvents are the mixture of the water and one or more water miscible solvents used to create a solution which enhance the solubility of poorly water soluble drugs. It means co-solvents are the water and one or more water miscible solvents are used to create the solution. These co-solvents helps us to improve the solubility of those drugs which are water, which shows poor water solubility. Now, the characteristics of a co-solvent. The co-solvent should be non-toxic, non-irritant, able to solubilize the drug in a given solvent, able to cross membrane. Value of dielectric constant should be between 25% to 80%. These are the characteristics that a co-solvent should possess. It means it should not impart any kind of toxicity. It should also should not show any kind of irritation. The co-solvent should be able to solubilize the drug of which we want to increase the solubility, and it it should also be soluble in the solvent in which we want to increase the solubility of the drug. And it should be able to cross the membrane. And it should also have the dielectric constant between 25 to 80. Widely used co-solvents means the examples of the co-solvents that we use in the pharmacy are glycerin, PEG, diethyl acetamide, glycerophyrol, ethyl lactate, ethyl alcohol. These are the few examples of the co-solvents that we use in the pharmacy. Now, the applications of the co-solvent are, they are used for the parenteral formulations, which may require the addition of water or as a dilute step before administration. The example is dimethyl sulfoxide or dimethyl acetate. These two chemicals can be used as a co-solvent because they have been widely used in the preparation, in the solubilization, and they have a great capacity to solubilize poorly water-soluble drugs within themselves. And because of their low toxicity, they are widely used. The next example is a blend of polyethylene glycol and water is used to improve the solubility of clotrimoxazole in the oil or in the oral solution. And the paracetamol is formulated as elixir by the use of alcohol and propylene glycol. The next approach by which we can improve the aqueous solubility is pH adjustment. Some solutes shows greater solubility at lower pH and some solutes will show greater solubility at higher pH. So it is very essential to adjust the pH of the solution. If there is any change in the pH of the solution, the solubility of the components will be decreased and there may be chances that the solutes may settle down or they get precipitated out. So to avoid this kind of things, pH adjustment is an essential step to improve the aqueous solubility of a formulation. And this can be achieved by adding the buffer in the formulation. As we have already discussed, buffers are those solutions which resist the change in the pH. Means, on addition of any small amount of acids or bases in the formulation, or when there is a change in the pH because of any environmental conditions, it can be temperature or humidity, to avoid such changes in the formulation, we need buffers. The buffer can resist the change in the pH. Buffers act by binding hydrogen ions in acids and donating hydrogen ions in base to control the potential change in the pH. Means they bind the hydrogen ions to the acids and they donate the hydrogen ions to base. And by this process, they will control the change in the pH. The selection of a suitable buffer should be based on the suitability of the acid-base form for the use in the oral liquids, stability of the drug and the excipient in the buffer, and the compatibility between the buffers and the containers. Means, while selecting the buffer, we have to consider all these parameters, that the buffer should be compatible with the drugs and excipients, and the buffer should also be compatible with the container in which we are going to put our drug at the end. The stabilizing effects of the buffers determines the potential reaction between the excipients and the drugs. For example, buffer containing carbonate, citrate, tartrate, and phosphate salts may precipitate with calcium ions by forming a sparingly soluble salts. Means if a formulation contains calcium salts and we are using carbonate, citrate or tartrate buffers along with that, they will form a they will decrease the solubility of that. They will form a sparingly soluble salts. On the other factors that may affect the solution is the pH, including the temperature, ionic strength, dilutions, and the amount and the type of the co-solvents that are present. As I already told you, temperature affects the change in the pH. Many of the there are many buffers that changes when the temperature changes. For example, if we take an acetate buffer, if we increase the temperature, the acidic buffer will show a change. Whereas in the pH of the boric buffers decreases with increase in temperature. Means if the temperature is increased in the case of acid buffers, the pH will increase. In the case of boric acid buffers, if we increase the temperature, the pH will decrease. pH adjustments. It is important to know that the drug in the solution may itself act as a buffer. Sometimes drug itself act as a buffer if the drug is a weak electrolyte, such as salicylic acid or ephedrine. If the drugs are salicylic acid or ephedrine, they are weak electrolytes, they themselves act as the buffer in the formulation. The addition of acid or base respectively will create system in which the drug act as a buffer. Example, phosphate buffers, acetate buffers, citric acid phosphate buffers, etc. These are the few examples of the pH of these second parameter, second approach to improve the aqueous solubility. Now, the third approach by which we can improve the solubility is complexation. Complexation means to forming a complex between the two substances, to make a new substance, to make a third substance. Complexation is formed when the complexing agent is added to the solution. It increases the solubility of the drug. There are different types of complexations. One is inorganic complexes, another is organic type of complexes, and third category is inclusion compounds. There are also metal complexes. So by forming different complexes, we can increase the solubility of a substance in the water. We will take an example. In this figure, you can see this is a cyclodextrin. Cyclodextrin molecules orient themselves in such a way that the interior of this cyclodextrin is hydrophobic in nature and the exterior of this cyclodextrin is hydrophilic in nature. Hydrophobic means it is lipid loving and water hating, and hydrophilic means water loving. Suppose we want to increase the solubility of an hydrophobic drug, means lipidic soluble drug. My drug is lipidic in nature, so it will not solubilize in water, or obviously it will not solubilize in water. And if I want to increase the solubility of that lipidic drug, I will go for this complexation. As the interior of this cyclodextrin is hydrophobic in nature and my drug is also hydrophobic in nature, so my drug can get easily incorporated inside this hollow sphere of this cyclodextrin. Now, the exterior of my cyclodextrin is hydrophilic in nature. So, this will help my drug to get solubilized into the aqueous in one. By making this complex, I can easily solubilize my drug in the aqueous in one. This is one of the example of the complexation. The next example is this theophylline. This theophylline is water insoluble compound. When the complex of this theophylline is made with this ethylene diamine molecule, the complex that is formed is known as aminophylline, which is a water soluble compound. Means at first these are the parent molecules, and by combining these two molecules we are getting a complex. This molecule is not water soluble, it shows low water solubility, and if I want to increase the water solubility of this theophylline, I am going to make the complex of this theophylline with this ethylene diamine, and the complex that is formed is known as aminophylline, and this complex is now water soluble. So by this we conclude that by forming a complexation we can easily improve the solubility of a drug in the aqueous environment. Our next category is microionization. Microionization means to reduce the particle size. The particle size is from 1 to 10 microns. And this small amount of particle size can be achieved by the processes of spray drying or fluidized energy mills. As we know that if we reduce the particle size, we increase the surface area of the particles. As the surface area of the particles are increased, it will increase the solubility of the particles, because surface area is directly proportional to the solubility of the particle. Our next method is hydrotrophy. The drug dissolved in a cluster of hydrophobic agents. Also, there is a drug hydrotropy agents that forms a complex to increase the drug solubility. The example of hydrotropic agents are urea, tosylate, cumene sulfonate, and xylene sulfonate. These are the few examples of the hydrotropic agents which will increase the solubility of the drugs in the which will form the complex with the insoluble drug and increase their solubility in the blood. The next method by which we can improve the aqueous solubility is solubilizing wetting and surfactants. Solubilizing agents promote the solubilization of poorly soluble drugs. Examples of solubilizing agents are macrogol ethers, polyoxyethylated sorbitan, sucrose monoesters, leolin esters. These are the few examples of the solubilizing agents. Wetting agents. Next is wetting agents. These are routinely used as they absorb at solid particle surface. They keep them away from the vehicle, which ultimately promotes the penetration of the vehicles into the pores and the capillaries of the vehicles. Wetting agents are a kind of surfactants that we use when we want to wet the surface of a substance. They will attach on the surface of the substance and reduce the interfacial tension between the two immiscible surfaces and increase the wettability of the compounds. For non-aqueous based formulations, mineral oils are commonly used as wetting agents, because hydrophobic drug particles are difficult to wet. Because of their hydrophilic phobic nature, means they are lipidic in nature, it is very difficult to wet a lipidic drug, because lipids are not soluble in water. They are of different different types, so they are not soluble in water. So in that case, it is very difficult to wet the lipidic drug. Even after removal of adsorbed air over the surface, even if we remove the adsorbed air that is over the surface of the particle, then also we cannot get the good wettability of any hydrophobic drug. In such cases, it is necessary to reduce the surface tension between the particles and the liquid vehicles. We have to reduce the surface tension that is between the particle that we want to dissolve and the liquid vehicle. Surface tension is the force that acts between the particles per unit area. Surface tension occurs, these two liquids are immiscible in each other because of the two kind of forces that act in the liquids. One is the cohesive force, another one is the adhesive force. Cohesive force is the force that is in between the same type of molecules. Means the forces that is acting between the water-water molecules or the oil-oil molecules are known as cohesive forces. And the adhesive forces are those forces which are acting between the different molecules. Means if the forces are acting in between the water and the oil is known as cohesive forces. If a substance have a stronger adhesive force, it will show less wettability. It will show high surface tension. If a substance has higher adsorptive force, in that case, it will show low surface tension. It means those two liquids will be easily able to mix in each other. But in the case where the substances are not miscible in each other, in those cases, we need some agents known as surface active agents or surfactants that will work as a wetting agent comprised of branched hydrophobic chains with central hydrophilic groups, a short hydrophobic chain and a hydrophilic end groups. This is the structure of a surfactant. This is the polar head which is hydrophilic in nature. Means this polar head is water loving in nature. And it also have a chain which is water hating. Means it is a non-polar, means it is soluble in lipid. So, the surfactant molecules are comprised of one polar head and a non-polar chain. It means it is soluble in both water as well as in oil. Those molecules which shows solubility in both oil, lipidic and in aqueous phase are known as amphiphilic molecules. As from the name, you can easily understand that surfactant means surface acting agents. Means these molecules act on the surface of or the interface of the liquids, because they possess both the characters. As you can see in this diagram, this blue portion is water and this yellow portion is oil. And these are the monomer units of the surfactants. The polar head of the surfactant is water soluble, so it will orient itself towards the water, whereas the non-polar tail is oil soluble or lipid soluble. It will orient itself towards the lipidic end. So they will arrange themselves on this interface and reduce the surface tension between this oil and the water, because this oil and water have a strong cohesive forces. Means they are not miscible in each other and they have a strong intermolecular forces of attraction. They have strong intermolecular forces of attraction. So these molecules, so if I want to mix this oil and if I want to improve the solubility of this oil in this water, I have to use such agents that are known as surfactants. These surfactants will orient themselves in this interface, as you can see in this diagram. If we keep on increasing the concentration of the surfactant, one time will be there when this whole interface will be saturated. It means there is no more space left at this interface where the molecules can get and attached. After that saturation of this interface, if we keep on adding the surfactant in this solution, they will start forming the micelles. Means these molecules will orient themselves in the circular. These surfactant molecules will orient themselves into the circular structures, and those circular structures are known as micelles. And the concentration and the minimum concentration at which these micelle forms are known as CMCs. So this is how the surfactant helps in dissolving the oil or any solid. You can also take an example of solid. Oil and water are mixed with each other, and this is an example of emulsion. But if we talk about a suspension, in suspension also, as the solid molecules are not soluble in the water phase, means they have the interfacial tension is more in the molecules of solids and the water. In that case also, we can use these surfactant molecules. These surfactant molecules will surround and cover those solid molecules at their interface, where there is an interface between the solid and the liquid, and they will helps in reducing the interfacial tension between the two phases, and helps in solubilizing the that solid particles into the liquids. So these surfactants or these wetting agents are very essential in solubilizing the solvents in the systems. There is an example, that is sodium lauryl sulfate. Sodium lauryl sulfate is one of the most commonly used surface active agent as a wetting agent, which when dissolved in the water, it lowers the contact angle of the water and supports in spreading of the water on the particle surface to remove the air layer at the surface and replace it with the liquid phase. Means if I want that my solid surface should be wettable, for that this contact angle should be less than 90 degrees Celsius. In this case, you will see that that this contact angle is more than 90. It means this water molecule will not be able to wet this surface. But if the contact angle between the water molecule and the surface is lower than the 90 degrees Celsius, in that case, the liquid will be able to wet the surface easily. And if this contact angle is zero, in that case, we will find that the surface is completely wet. The references, students can go through the books from Pharmaceuticals 2, that is from R.M. Mehta, and Cooper and Guns, that is of pharmaceutical dispensing of pharmaceuticals. We can use these books to go through these preparations. Now, there are a few questions that we should discuss that we have read in this formulation, in this presentation. First is, what are liquid dosage form? As we have already discussed, that liquid dosage form is the combination of the active drug and the excipient together. Active drug and the excipient are mixed in a vehicle, and then the formulation is formed, that is known as liquid dosage form. Now, next is the classification of the liquid dosage form. We have classified liquid dosage forms into two categories. One is your monophasic liquid dosage form, another one is your biphasic liquid dosage form. In monophasic liquid doses form, we have classified them further into two categories. One is the liquids for internal use. Examples were syrups, linctus, and another one is the liquid doses forms that are for external use. And the examples are lotion, liniments, and in biphasic category, the liquid we have discussed about two types of liquid doses form. One is emulsion, another one is suspension. Suspensions are those liquid doses form in which a solid drug is insoluble in liquid state. So to dissolve that solid drug in that, to suspend that solid drug in that liquid state, a suspending agent or a surfactant is needed. With the help of a surfactant, the solid molecules which are insoluble in liquid are mixed together. Another one is emulsions. Another example of biphasic liquid doses form is emulsion. In emulsion, there are two immiscible liquids that are mixed together to form a formulation system. And these two immiscible liquids are mixed together with the help of an emulsifying agent. Next question is, what are vehicles used in the liquid doses forms? First we should understand what are vehicles. Vehicles are those substances in which we incorporate our drug and the excipients. Means these vehicles, the liquid that is used to solubilize the excipient and the drug in it are known as vehicles. The vehicles we have discussed, the vehicles are of two types. One is the aqueous vehicles and another one is the non-aqueous vehicles. In aqueous vehicles, we widely use water as an aqueous vehicle. And why we use water? Because of its high dielectric constant, because of its low toxicity, because of its high compatibility. So we use water widely as an aqueous vehicle. There are different types of known aqueous vehicles that we have discussed. For example, alcohol, oils that we use for the preparation of the formulations. Next is, write down the importance of buffers in liquid doses form. Why buffers are very much important in our systems? As I already discussed, that there are some drugs that are soluble at lower pH and some drugs are soluble at higher pH. While formulating a formulation, we are maintaining the pH in which a particular drug is soluble. But because of the environmental conditions, in some cases, there are chances that because of the temperature, because of the humidity, there are chances that there is a change in the pH of the solution. And if the pH of the solution will change, it will cause insolubility of the additives that we have added in that particular formulation. To overcome that problem, we need buffers. Buffers are those systems which resist the change in the pH. And we select the buffers on the basis of what pH we need and on the basis of the buffer capacity that we require. Now, what is the buffer capacity? Buffer capacity is the capacity of a buffer if we formulate a liquid system and we are adding a strong acid and a strong base in that particular system. How much concentration of that pH that we are adding from the from outside, that buffer that is present in that formulation can resist that change in the pH is known as the capacity of that particular buffer. Now, the next question is, what are the advantages and the disadvantages of the liquid doses form? We have already discussed the advantages of liquid doses form is that they shows rapid adsorption. because unlike solid molecules, the liquid molecules do not go through disintegration and dissolution pathway. It means they do not have to disintegrate and dissolve. As soon as we take the liquid dosage form, they directly go to the adsorption. And because of that, we will get a faster action. So we can use this activity in the case of where we need a faster action. For example, we want to a faster pain relieving agents. We can use this property. The next advantage of liquid dosage form is that it is very useful in the case where the patients are not able to take the drug through the solid route. For example, if the patient is unconscious at that time, in that case, if we want to administer a drug to the patient, liquid dosage form will be the best way to deliver the drug. The next advantage is that liquid dosage form can be used in the elderly people and in the children's. Liquid dosage forms such as syrups, children, because they are sweeter in taste, children likes to have those kind of liquid dosage form. And in liquid dosage form, there is no difficulty of swelling, so elderly people and children can easily swallow that formulation. So this is the these are the advantages that we get from the liquid dosage form over the tablet dosage form. Now the disadvantages: there are chances of microbial contamination in the case of liquid dosage form, because in the liquid dosage form we use water as a vehicle. We commonly use water as a vehicle. Water gives us the chance to the microbial growth. So there are a chance that the microbial growth can occur in a system. The handling of liquid dosage forms are difficult as those of in tablets, as those of in solid, because they are liquid in nature, so their handling will be difficult. Dose accuracy is also a problem in the liquid dosage form, because in the tablets there are fixed dose, but in liquid dosage form we take a dose with the help of a spoon, or we will not measure the dose. So for example, in the case of suspension, as we know that the particles are suspended in the liquid dosage form at a particular time, in few weeks, the particles will start settling down. And if a patient does not shake the suspension, the particles will not spread throughout the, the dose of the drug will not spread throughout the liquid. And if the patient is taking that supernatant, then the concentration that is reaching in our body will be less. So dose accuracy is also a problem in the case of liquid dosage form. Another disadvantage is that because of the rapid adsorption, sometimes these liquid dosage form can cause toxicity, because the drug will fastly reach into the rate of adsorption is high in the liquid dosage form, so they directly reach into the blood, and because of that we can get toxicity sometimes. But this can be overcome by using some excipients. We can control the release of the drug by using these excipients. So these are the advantages and the disadvantages of the liquid dosage form. Next question is, describe the role of the pH adjustments in the liquid dosage form. As I discussed, the pH is an essential parameter in the liquid dosage form. Some drugs shows solubility at lower pH. Some drugs will show solubility at higher pH. Or there are other examples also. For example, if I want to administer a drug, if I want to prepare an ophthalmic preparation, it means if I want to deliver my drug into my eye, in that case, if I will not maintain the pH of the liquid, it will cause irritation and it will cause redness into the eye. Another example is that कि इफ वी आर टेकिंग सम ड्रग पेरेंटरली द पीएच ऑफ द ब्लड इज 7.4 एंड इफ वी आर नॉट मेंटेनिंग द पीएच ऑफ द लिक्विडोसिस फॉर्म एंड वी आर गिविंग इट पेरेंटरली इन दैट केस ऑल्सो वी विल कॉजिंग टॉक्सिसिटी और वी विल कॉजिंग पेन और टॉक्सिसिटी इन द सिस्टम. So it is very essential to maintain the pH of the liquid, and this can be maintained by using the buffers. What are the excipients used in the liquid doses forms? There are many excipients. There are numerous of excipients that we use while preparing a liquid doses form. We have discussed many of them. I'll enlist few of them. One is the vehicle. Vehicle is that excipient in which the API and the excipients are mixed, and the other excipients are mixed in it. Another example is buffers. We use buffer as an excipient in the liquid doses form to adjust the pH of the liquid. Next is viscosity enhancer. As we have discussed, it is very essential to maintain the viscosity of a liquid if I am using it in transdermal, through a transdermal route, or if I want if I using it in suspensions, because if I want that if I'm applying a drug over my skin and it has lower viscosity, it will not retain on my skin and the drug will not penetrate through the skin. To avoid that, I have to increase the viscosity of the liquid so that it can retain on the skin, and the penetration of the drug, the time to penetrate the drug through that route can be possible. And we have also discussed this viscosity is important in the case of suspensions, because in the suspensions the particles may settle down over a period of time because they are not soluble in this liquid doses form. So in that case, if I add the if I increase the viscosity of the liquid, that viscous liquid will slower the sedimentation rate of those undissolved particles. So our first excipient was vehicle, our second excipient was buffers, third was your viscosity enhancer, and the fourth excipients that we use are colorants. Colors are used to improve the appearance of a liquid doses form, or they will there are different types of colors that we use to appear the to increase the appearance of the enhance the appearance of the liquid doses form. The next excipient that we use is the flavoring agents. If a liquid doses form has a good flavor, we can use those flavoring agent to mask the foul odor of a drug substance. Means if a drug substance is have a foul odor, and if we take it and that drug substance, the patient will not feel comfortable in taking that drug substance. So we can use the flavoring agent to mask that foul odor of that particular drug. And the last excipient that we use is the sweetening agent. There are numerous sweetening agents that we can use for the preparation of liquid formulation, but sucrose is the most commonly used excipient that we use in the preparation of liquid formulation. And why we use it? Because of it, it's colorless, because it is stable in the wide pH range, that is 4 to 8, and because of its it provide viscosity to the liquid in which we are solubilizing it. So and why we need the sweetening agents? Some drugs are very bitter in taste, so they are not acceptable by the patients, and the patients are not comfortable in taking those drugs. To avoid that bitter taste, to overcome that bitter taste, we use these sweetening agents to so that to improve the patient compliance, so that the patient can easily have that liquid medicine. Now enlist these next question is enlist these solubility enhancement techniques. there are different techniques by which we can enhance the solubility of the drug. First is by using surfactants. As we have discussed, the surfactant are the surface active molecules. They are they have a polar head and a non-polar tail. It means they are miscible in both the phases. It means they are miscible in liquid as in the organic phase as well as in the non-organic as well as the as in the aqueous phase. So they arrange themselves on the surface and reduces the interfacial tension between the molecules and enhance their solubility. The surfactants we used in the preparation of biphasic liquids form, as in emulsions as well as in suspensions. The next component, next solubility enhancement technique is your wettability. Wettability is the kind of surfactant which helps to reduce the surface tension between the solid surface as well as the liquid, means water. If the solid is lipidic in nature, it is very difficult to improve its wettability because lipids are not soluble in water. In that case, we have to add some surfactants or these wettability agents in them. These wettability agents will reduce the area of contact. It will minimize the area of contact. If I want to improve the wettability of a substance, the area of contact should be less than 90 degrees Celsius. If it is more than 90 degrees Celsius, wettability will not take place. But if it is less than 90 degrees Celsius, wetting process will start. And if it is zero, it means the substance is completely wet. So these are this is the second solubility enhancer. The third solubility enhancer is your complexation. As I have complexation are the there are different types of complexes. One is metal ion complexes, another one is organic molecular complexes, and last one is that inclusion compounds. These are the three categories of the complexation. We can use any of the complex to enhance the solubility of a particular substance. For example, that example that we have taken was of cyclodextrin. We have discussed this about the structure of the cyclodextrin. As we know, the cyclodextrin molecules orient themselves in such a way that the interior of the cyclodextrin is lipidic in nature and the exterior of the cyclodextrin is aqueous in nature. So if I want to dissolve my aqueous my lipidic drug, and if I want to increase the solubility of my lipidic drug in a water in an aqueous medium, in that case I have to incorporate that lipidic drug into the interior of my cyclodextrin. As the exterior is hydrophilic, by this, in this way, I can increase the solubility of my substance. So these are the few techniques that we use for increasing the solubility of the substance. And the last technique for increasing the solubility of a substance is co-solvency. Co-solvency means I have to, with my vehicle, with my main solvent, I have to take a co-solvent along with my main solvent. Suppose a drug is lipidic in nature and it is not soluble in water, and I want to increase its solubility in water, I have to solubilize that drug in another solvent. That solvent will act as a co-solvent. The selection of co-solvent is on the basis that co-solvent should be able to mix the drug that I want to get the mix the drug whose solubility I want to improve, and it also solubilize in that water phase also. Means it should show the solubility in both in the water as well as in that drug. By this, I can improve the solubility of the drug. These are the few techniques. There is one more, that is pH enhancement. By adjusting the pH of the solution we can increase the solubility of few substances. So these are the few techniques that are helpful in enhancing the solubility of some substances. Next question is, describe the role of solubilizing wetting agents and surfactant in the solubilization of poorly soluble drugs. I have already discussed in this case, in this enhancement of solubility techniques, I have already discussed in it. The next is, what do you understand by viscosity enhancement, and describe the importance of that in liquid dosage form. As I already discussed, that viscosity enhancement is very essential in the case of liquid dosage form, so that if I want to apply a drug transdermally, I want that my drug should retain on the transdermal, on that my skin, so that the penetration of the drug can be achieved. In that case, viscosity enhancements is very essential, and also in the case of suspension, the viscosity